throughout the country. And here to talk about that and more is Jay Shofet, the Director of Partnerships and Development for the Society for the Protection of Nature in Israel. And Jay, thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Kalev.
Well, let's start with ecological corridors. What is that exactly?
Well, ecological corridors are living, breathing passageways that allow wildlife to get from one habitat to another. It's important because species need diversity in order to maintain their biodiversity. They need to have different populations that can connect with each other. And in Israel, which is such a rapidly developing country, such a small country anyway, and we're such a hot spot of biodiversity in the world, it's all the more important that we maintain corridors between the dwindling habitats.
Right, we're showing a little map there that has there on the screen that's showing some of those green areas. Let's talk about a couple of the specific areas. I live in the Jerusalem area, Jay, and there's a lot of talk now about overdevelopment, particularly in that area, and concern and opposition, which I'm sure SPNI and other local groups are also very involved in.
Well, we've been fighting development in the Jerusalem Hills for many years now, together with a really wide coalition of citizens groups in and around Jerusalem. They keep wanting to tear down the open areas and the forests around Jerusalem rather than do what we need to do in Israel and in the world in general, which is build dense, sustainable cities. We need to fill in a lot of the places in Jerusalem. We need to build high-rises because we live in such a tiny country. We're the third most densely populated country in the OECD, and that doesn't even include the Negev, that includes the Negev, where almost nobody lives. So we really have a problem in rampant development and non-sustainable development, eating up all our open spaces, our biodiversity, and those crucial ecological corridors that keep habitats connected one to another.
Right. Now, that map we showed was, of course, of the land mass of the land of Israel, but we know we also have to be aware of the maritime, territory or area that Israel holds responsible for, and this would include that as well. We saw certainly graphic illustration with this recent oil tar spill wash-up of the dangers of ignoring that.
Absolutely. We call it actually the sea reserves of Israel, the blue half. Like the other half of Israel really is the part of Israel that goes into the sea. Our territorial waters are 9 kilometers from shore, and our economic waters are 40 kilometers from shore, and they're not regulated at all. We have to make sure that there's up-to-date regulation which keeps those seas clean, both from the drilling, the gas drilling platforms, and from overfishing. There's a lot to do to maintain that wildlife, crucial wildlife in the sea.
Right. Now, understandably, there's a lot of focus on climate change and its impact on this Earth Day. And that's been an increasingly focus in environmental circles in the US. How does that apply to here in Israel, its impact?
Here in Israel, where it was 100 degrees a couple days ago in mid-April, and where we're going to be suffering greatly and relatively greatly by the change in climate, by global warming, by the rise in seas, because of where we are here in the Middle East, days will become too hot to live within our lifetimes, probably, Kalev. Without air conditioning. But it's not, and so climate change, we can't overestimate how crucial it is to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, create sustainable, renewable energy. Our politicians need to do it. Our citizens need to be aware of it. That's crucial. But here again, in this dense country, it's kind of also all about planning, because we are also in the middle of the sixth mass extinction event. We're losing species at 1,000 times higher than the normal rate. Every day we're losing hundreds of species on this earth. And that is due to climate change and all kinds of weirdnesses in the global weather patterns, but also due to that rampant overdevelopment and the fact that we're just eating up the habitats where so many of the crucial wildlife that we're dependent on, for healthy ecosystems in the globe, they're disappearing because we're taking up too much land.
No, it's funny, Jay, because people are more maybe aware of wildlife because they see these wild boars in Haifa and Jerusalem. We start to see foxes and porcupines and animal hyenas in the city, as if it's like wildlife is flourishing, but it's really the opposite. It's really we're expanding into their area, and that is creating this kind of phenomena.
That's exactly true. I mean, the boars, we keep moving Haifa out, and we keep limiting their habitats outside of Haifa, so they're overpopulating and they're becoming a nuisance. And it's true that it was great to see even in the small time that COVID affected us, that we were inside and there was less global transportation and less sea transportation, we saw wildlife come back. And that's the good news. We know that for example, to protect the oceans, and if you saw Seaspiracy like millions have in the last, the most important thing we can do is leave the sea alone. Wildlife will come back if we leave the sea alone and if we leave these open spaces alone. All the habitats of Israel, the wetland habitats, the bird migration flyways, the deserts, the Batha, the Mediterranean scrubland, all of these habitats need to be left as much as possible. I mean, of course we are very conscious of human development and the needs of Israelis to live a healthy life, but a green sustainable Israel is going to beckon the world. It's going to be a light into the nations. Not an Israel that's overcrowded, where wildlife can barely survive, and where the pollution on the beaches and other open spaces is terrible, as we've seen.
Well, God willing, that will be the situation in the coming years. Jay Shelford from the Society for the Protection of Nature in Israel. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you
on the Rundown. We're going